Yeah, so I'm Pejman. I know many of you here, which is awesome. And I'm gonna talk about what I've been doing recently, let's say, in terms of working with India studios. But before I start my talk, there are a couple of other things that I want to mention in addition to Seb's birthday. There are some other reasons that today is quite a special day for me. So I started my games user research, or my career as a user researcher in the game industry back in 2009, 1st of October. So this is my 7-year anniversary of doing this, which is quite cool. And then in the last 7 years, I've benefited a lot from the game user research community. And I've tried also to give back to this community. I've organized 5-6 workshops at the Kai conference and Kai Play conference. I've organized courses, and we are also writing a book on game user research. But I've never been to Game User Research Summit, so this is my first time speaking at this event, which I'm super excited about. And I used to live in England, in London, and it's very awesome to be back here and among you guys to do this. But all these things also makes me quite nervous. And it was funny because, you know, as part of my job, I'm a university lecturer, so I give lots of talks. And then one of my students or researcher who works with me, he asked me if I'm nervous for my talk for this conference. And I was like, no, I'm not nervous, it's okay, I've done lots of talks. And then he was like, but they are your peer, they are your friend. I was like, oh yeah, it's kind of nerve-wracking. And he was like, oh, your PhD supervisor is gonna be there, no? I was like, yeah, he's gonna be here. So hi, Graham. Yeah. So yeah, it's quite interesting event for me. Before I start my talk, I have a quick question for you guys. So how many of you, maybe show a hand, consider yourself as an academic who is doing games user research? Yeah, you? Cool. And then how many of you are game user researcher in the game industry? Cool. And then how many are game developers? So you are game developer. Cool. So that's cool. So my talk, I try to cover things that I think it's going to be it's useful for those who are in academics, obviously, because I kind of have two positions. I'm going to talk about them. And also the way that most of the material, I think it's very useful if you're going to work with India studios. So if you have a kind of a consultancy, or if you give feedback to a small team, so these stuff hopefully going to be useful for you. If you are a game developer, this talk might be less useful, but there is another version of this talk I'm going to give at Mix conference in a couple of weeks. That's designed for game designers or game developers, so you'll see. So to start with, as I said, I used to live in England, so I did my PhD at University of Sussex, started in 2009 to 2013, and my PhD focused on application of physiological measures in games user research. So there are loads of, I would say, research on physiological measures, but I like to think that my PhD was kind of the first one who actually looked at how they can be applied in user research, so to provide formative feedback during game evaluation. So that's what I did for 4 or 5 years. I still do research on, you know, using physiological measures in games. And I was very lucky as part of my PhD because I, with Graham, I got to work at Vertical Slice and later Player Research. And that basically framed my whole thesis because it was all on real games that we were working on. Of course, we worked on more than four games. These are just maybe some examples or some of my favorites from four years of doing that. And one thing I want to mention, or actually helped me in my career, because at both Vertical Slice and later Crysis, I had the opportunity to work on different type of game, different genres, different platform. And like one of the projects that I really enjoyed was I was working on Wonderbook for I think more than 2 years. We worked with awesome people at Sony user research team in London on that project, or working on one of the first titles that was released with Microsoft Kinect. So those were awesome. In 2013, 2013, toward the end of 2013, I made a decision, maybe a risky decision, I don't know yet, but we will see, I think, in the next few years. And I accepted position as an assistant professor at UIT, so I moved to Canada, and at UIT, we have a game development program as an undergrad, so 4 years program that the students can take. And I was telling Graham, actually, when I told him that I'm leaving, I'm going to Canada, and he asked, you know, why, what happened? And I said, I want to fix the problem from the base, so I'm going to teach developers as they are students to care more about their users and the player. And that was my aim when I joined the industry. So during the last 3.5 or 4 years now at UIT, I introduced courses. So in our program, there is actually a game user research course that the student has to take. It's a mandatory course to complete their degree. And we have a minor in game user research. So if students want to specialize in that, there is a set of elective courses that they have to take to be able to work in a game user research field. And of course, we also offer graduate degrees, which I supervise for master and PhD students in this topic. But one thing that kind of bothered me from moving to Canada was the connection that I had in the UK. So I had to rebuild my network there. And I was very lucky that I was approached by Jason DeLaRocca at Execution Lab, and he asked me, they had an opening for a user research director, and he told me they couldn't find, it was a hard field, and most of you have worked for the industry, you know that's a difficult position to fill. And then he said they interviewed many people, but they couldn't find someone who would have a wide variety of experience and be able to kind of teach, because one of the vision that he has for Execution Lab is to help developers and teach them to do user research as well. And then after some discussion, we were like, okay, maybe you might be a good fit for our need. And that's how I got to start working with Execution Lab in January 2015. And as part of Execution Lab, I worked on many games. I'm going to have more information on that soon. But these talks basically influenced by the knowledge I got in the last couple of years. Not maybe knowledge, it's basically challenges that I face at the moment. And I'm going to talk about them. So basically, I call this lesson learned, but it's actually not lesson learned. It's mostly what I'm trying to do, and I need your help to help me in my process. So this talk is not going to be about scientific facts. It's more on what I'm doing, and I'm looking forward to get your ideas on that, and hopefully discuss this together. So in my talk today, I'm going to talk a little bit about Execution Lab and what we do and some of the studios that we work with. And then majority of my talk going to focus on working with India studios and kind of the challenges that I face, as I mentioned. And also a portion of it, because I'm kind of having wearing these two hats as a university professor and as a user research director. So part of that kind of cover what I feel from how these two part of the community maybe can work together, or my understanding of that. So in terms of Execution Lab, we are, I think most of you probably know Jason DeLaRocca, the founder of the Execution Lab, but we are hands-on early stage investor. So what for India Studio. So what that means is the main goal is to support indie development, and we try to invest in new teams. We are obviously looking for creative and new ideas, but the investment is not limited to give them a cash and say, okay, off you go. Here is X amount of dollar. Go and build your game. But there is a team of what they call it experts that helps these small studios in terms of making them to be a sustainable studio and apply for bigger or attract bigger investment, either it's from the publisher, from crowdsource funds. So that's our main mission. So there is a director or game director who is helping the teams with their production needs, Astrid. She is a community developer, so offering consultancy and helps with the team in terms of building the community around their game or in the team. Lizian, she's our business director, business analytic director, or business intelligence. So she works, help the team to implement analytics in their games. And I'm the user research guy, offering my help and consultation for that. We have 19. There are 19 studios that we are currently working with. In terms of my work, it varies how much I work with different studios. It depends on which stage of development they are. If they are a new studio or old studio, and what sort of relationship we have with them. But I work with most of these guys. And one of the games that we released yesterday. Our Ottermind studio is one of the execution labs studio released yesterday. It's a new Pewdiepie game called Tube Simulator, or YouTuber Simulator, and it's currently number one on App Store, so we are very proud. We are very proud of that. But in terms of what I'm doing and what I learned from that, or how, when we want to work with in the studio. So the first thing that I think it's one of the most important considerations, and it's not only for India studios, I think it's for everyone doing user research, is the team that you have and you work with. I'm very lucky at Execution Lab because of Lizzie, and we worked together a lot in terms of implementing analytics and user research, or in most cases in our playtesting, and I think we are doing some very interesting work. And also I'm relying on Derek helps as a producer to kind of facilitate or help me to get the information I need from the team, or force them to consider maybe user research more. So that's the execution lab part. From the university part, I have my team. There are 12 user researchers that I currently work with. All of them are somehow involved with UIT, so they're either PhD student, master's student, or undergraduate user, undergraduate research assistant. So basically, to achieve my goal, which is to help the India studios, this is the team that we put together, and it helps a lot. But the good team is not the only part. And one thing I found really important in working and helping India studios is that they need training in terms of being able to do user research themselves. And you may disagree with me, and that's fine, because I thought it's not a good idea to actually teach developers how to do user research. I thought user research always should be done by those who are trained as a user researcher, and that's their only job. But and it was funny, because I think a few years ago, I was in Montreal, and I had a dinner with Ian Livingston. Some of you know him. And that's what he was telling me, that, oh, he thinks that we should teach developers to be able to do user research themselves. And I disagree with him. I was like, no, that's not a good idea. I don't think they're going to be able to do that. But now I've learned that, especially in the indie cases, if we want to achieve, or if user research wants to have an impact there, then the developers need to be trained to be able to do some part of this process themselves. And we all probably can agree on some of the limitations that indie teams have, such as a smaller budget or limited resources. Therefore, the involvement with the user, the developer's involvement is more important. And throughout the talk, I'm going to make some references to that as well. But the first approach when we want to run user tests on a project is to know what we have to evaluate. Sometimes, if you are the member of the development team or the same publisher, you may get some design document, or even like bigger team, they are more documented. And that's not the case usually with a small indie studio. It's usually a few guys sit together. They are very creative, very knowledgeable. They want to build a game, but they necessarily don't have a game design document to give you. And this is the kind of a stage or a steps that we try to define to help us measure the correct thing, let's say. So I usually, and you guys do the same thing, when you approach a new project, you want to ask them, okay, what question do you want me to answer? And they always have loads of questions, which is really good. But the part that often missing is what do you want as a developer to create? What's your design intent? I have an example. I didn't mean for you guys to read this. That's why it's very small. But I just want to show you the kind of steps. So there are different sections in their game, section, subsection, and then the goal or question they have for each of those sections or their design intent. And then this part, this is what we feel as a, we complete as a team. So what type of measures can be used to be able to answer that question. So very simple steps and very effective to get the developers to tell us what they want to know about their game. Because without that, plus with limited resources and budget, we cannot just wander around and let's see, you know, what happened, let's run a test and give you some feedback at the end. The other thing is, of course, selecting, you know, the method that you want to use, or basically designing your study. And this is, again, very important, because designing the study, it has a direct impact on the cost of running that study. And again, back to that resource issue, this is what we always need to consider. So one cost is the cost of those participants. So coming up, at least the approach that I'm trying to adopt there is running or using fewer participants, but running in iteration. So we don't do one playtest with like 20, we do maybe 5 playtests with 4 on a different iteration, and then we want to see that involvement, as well as to select methods that they try to complement or validate, if you like, if validate is a good word, the findings from each of them. As part of the cost, of course, is the lab cost, renting a space. And I have a slide to talk about that soon, and as well as the researchers' cost. So that's another part that both are things that we can save money. And we had to be creative in finding methods that we can still get a usable data, but also not very expensive. And I have a couple of graph or diagrams here. And that's something that we are doing. And I wonder what you guys think about it. Or actually wonder if anyone actually using game analytics, many of you are going to say yes, but using game analytics during a playtest and feedback the data immediately into the results. So it's the games are still in very early stage. We have only 5 players or 10 players coming to play, but we still collect the analytics data. And I didn't think it's going to be useful, but then working with Lizian, we found ways that we could implement those data in our playtesting report, or into saving some money. There is one example here. So here it shows the position, the blue one a position and green one is the jump. It's one of the platformer games that we worked on. And the interesting thing in this game was we run, I think, overall, we had something around 40 hours of observation, recorded data to watch, and it's expensive to have researchers to watch that. So we kind of try to go through them as fast as possible. So we arguably missed some important information. But what analytics helped us, even with that few players we had, it showed that there is something happening for this player in level 2, that our observation didn't report that. So what we did, we went back to the video and rewatched that video for specifically those events that were identified through analytics. And this is another example. So another game, we have multiple levels in a board, and in this particular level, we've noticed that players spend significantly more time in completing that. We didn't have enough resources to watch everything, but knowing that, we went back and watched the video of this one level a couple of times to see why they spent more time there, what was the issue there. So that's another way that I would argue that it saved our resources. And one thing that we've recently started doing, and I think it's quite cool, is we build a dashboard that helps us to get a very fast result from our analytics. So as soon as the playtest finish, I have a few important metrics to use in my, let's say, post-session interview. In this case, there are some upgrades that the player could use, and the designers assume that, you know, they should kind of use all of them in the same frequency. But what happened after the playtest, we noticed one of them got used the most. So we could basically include that in our post-session interview, asking the users to tell us how they pick different resources or why they pick certain resources more than often. So this is one application on using these analytics immediately or as part of the playtest or immediately after that. The other point, of course, is participant recruitment. And that's one of the interesting part and also expensive part of the process. We have populated the database, participant database. One mistake that we made, and it was quite interesting, is we started advertising our playtest database using Execution Lab Twitter account or Facebook. What happened? All Jason's friends signed up to our playtesting database. And then I tried to recruit, and I called them to confirm. I'm like, yeah, I'm so excited. I'm gonna come there because I miss you guys. I haven't seen you. I'm like, look, you're not a good participant for me. Sorry. So what we learned was that our immediate network is not the best place to look for players. So we started advertising in like local website or you know. Things like, I forgot the name of the one, Gumtree in the UK, something similar to that. But then some of them were more intended towards like a job position. So we got some people sign up that they thought it's the job. So we had to filter those. But one thing that, or the other portion of recruitment is, of course, selecting the participant. And in order to facilitate that, I've created a template for our devs to use it. So based on the discussion that we would have with them when we are designing a session, based on the recruitment requirement that we have, then I share the database with them and ask them to, you know, there is obviously search option, they can do filters, to select the people that they think are the best for their games. And then there is a template for them to invite them for a playtest and all the steps that we know that we need to take care of. But one thing that I, again, one little tips here is I also ask the teams to comment on the database or color code depending on, you know, how the participants behave. For example, the guys that don't show up, they get a black mark, so they're out. We're never gonna contact them. Some people come and they are naturally good at Think Loud. They get a green badge here, so we kind of consider them for future. And then we also mark those who participated in our study that we don't want to recruit them again. So they're gonna be marked there as well. So a couple of tips, but there are loads of talks or resources to read about those recruitment as well. Another thing that we try to adopt is our lab. So we don't have the luxury of our own beautiful, dedicated user research lab. So again, we had to be creative in how we're gonna run user research or playtest without biasing our participants a lot. So what we have is a dividable meeting room, and then the way we design it is that we could turn it into two different small room, one for players, so the one here on the top. There is the microphone, a little webcam, capture card, and they are all connected to a recording computer and a screen that the developers can sit in a separate observation room and watch what's going on and discuss that and would have less impact on the participants. But you know, doing it in a lab is not maybe always an option. So I especially after working on Wonderbook project and being too many houses, I'm quite a fan of running the studies in participants' houses. And this is an example. So again, very cheap setup, just a webcam and camera and a recording machine. Of course, running these type of studies are more complicated than those. So I usually conduct these myself and make sure to, you know, approach the users in a way that I would bias them less. And sometimes we also rent basically research lab that are kind of multi-purpose lab that are equipped with ceiling camera that's zoomable. So again, depending on the type of a study, we try to be creative in where we would test that. Another very interesting point that I learned is the different timeline that the indie developers have in compared to AAA developers that I used to work a lot with. And that's, I basically called it, can you fit with the next more important thing in my timeline or not? Yeah, they are preparing a demo for E3, and they are trying to submit a CMF, which is a government media fund application, and they also have meetings with publishers. So the question they have sometimes is like, I'm meeting this publisher next week, how can you help me to be better? Or I'm going to E3, how can you help me to have a better demo there? Or can I have a copy of the playtesting result because I want to show it to the potential publisher next week? So, and that created loads of interesting challenges in our work, because sometimes we agreed on some sort of a timeline, and then a team would say that, sorry, we are doing our Kickstarter video and it's more important for us. But I wish I could say that, oh, okay, since you are doing the Kickstarter, this is how I can help you in making your Kickstarter better. And I haven't figured out many of these yet. So this is what I wonder if there is a way that we could adopt to be able to help them in those more important things that they have in their timeline. One other point, and I think that's quite unique to maybe indie developer, again, environment. And that's what I called it, the issue with authority. I'm gonna give you an example. Most of the games, or AAA games that I worked on, I either reported to game designer, game director, or creative director, and their job was to communicate that. I mean, we would give them a report and they probably would send it to them, but their job was, if I could convince the creative director that that's an issue and it has to be fixed, it would potentially get fixed. And that's the example hierarchy that I just Googled to put there. So let's say they're probably a small team or big team working on a project in a AAA studio, but there is a super big organization. So the head of that studio may not necessarily know what's going on in this game or may not need to be involved in making those final decisions. But in indie, it's a very different model. A team of three, and they're all some sort of a CEO or CO or CTO. And so you deal with this guy, you convince him, and then the CEO is also a programmer. And the CEO come in that, no, I don't want to change that. And then you're like, okay, but you know, your co-founder said he's gonna do it. So, and the issue is they have the same authority usually in the company. Again, as I mentioned, in bigger company, if the creative director agrees to do that, he or she asked the programmer to implement the changes. Here, the programmer is also a CEO, so he can say that, look, I'm not gonna do that. And so that's one issue. The other thing here is the type of investment. So I know that people in bigger studios, they are invested in the game, that they are working. But these guys, the smaller studio, they are not only personally invested, but they are financially invested. So they use their own saving, or even maybe their parents or their partner's saving to build that game. So all the issue we heard earlier this morning about motivating them or convincing them, like multiply that to 100, because it's their own or even their parents' money that they put in building the game. And I thought that's quite an interesting challenge for doing user research for indie studios. One other part that I wanted to highlight is the importance of having this user research community. And I'm very thankful for those guys who volunteer and run this community. And it's been awesome, awesome resource for us. Because in bigger studios, you are, even as a user researcher, you probably work with a team of another 5 user researchers. And then you have a user research director. And you have resources to go and talk to. But the smaller studios, they are, sometimes we call them lonely developers. And they need those resources. So the website that's been redesigned and improved with all the resources, that's an amazing tool for them because they need to refer to these resources in order to learn about what they're doing and use that. One issue that I would like to highlight is sometimes, unfortunately, our community, although it's a small, but I've seen there is an inconsistency in the terminologies that we use. Even our job title might be different. So I call myself user research director, and then there are my friends might be a UI director, but they do user research. Another friend, he's a UX director, and he's kind of doing the same thing. And for us, it might be justifiable if you say, okay, what is user research and why it is UX? Probably we can find the justification and agree on that. But for those indie studios, that's a confusing thing. You know, I tell them, you learn about user research, and then they go and say that, oh, but someone told me this is UX research, or it's a UX and UI, so which one are we doing? So I wish maybe another survey Seb can design, in addition to the salary one, that we can maybe come up with some terminology, and as a community, maybe we can agree to use that, because it would impact the way that developers would see our work. And as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to talk a little bit about user research in industry and academia. I'm quite proud of being able to do that both thing at the same time. It's very difficult, lots of sleepless nights, but I think it's very rewarding, and I tell you why I think it's rewarding. And I also going to share some of my view. You may disagree with that, but that's okay. That's how I think. Maybe we can discuss that, and that we can agree on something cool. But this type of relationship won't be possible without the support of both organizations. At UIT, I'm very lucky with the management or higher level management at the university that they support kind of their faculty's crazy ideas. Especially in our university, so the Office of Research and Partnership and Contracts, they've been super helpful in finding a way, because university, they like, you know, bureaucracy and paperwork and everything, and that doesn't work when you want to work with industry. So they were very helpful to find something that could satisfy the both side, let's say. One thing that we did, and I thought that was quite an achievement, we basically made a template in our research office that kind of detailed everything that they want. And then we signed that with Execution Lab, so that's done. And then we have a one-page project info that when there is a new project that we work on, we just sign that, and then that's it. So there was a big discussion on the big piece, but the smaller one, which we sign frequently, that's something fast and easy to achieve. Also, I'm lucky with my faculty or my home faculty that values these collaboration. I try to make argument because this impacts my students' work, obviously. All my graduate students or the team that I mentioned earlier, they are involved with this project and some other project that I work on, and I think that makes a valuable contribution to their education. The industry part, Jason and Keith both been very supportive in understanding the limitation or the challenges from working with industry, and also understanding the workload that I have to deal with as well. So let's say during the exam time that I'm like super busy, I may have less time for execution lab project, and they are very flexible with that. This is one of the scary ones. So this is how I see the relationship between academic and industry in terms of user research. And again, as I said, you may disagree with that. But I see the industry people, usually the project that we work on, it's an underdevelopment game. And that would have its own criteria. So we do the user research process on that, whatever is needed. And then we come up with some sort of a evaluation result. And I would like to call it formative evaluation, because the intention is to make that underdevelopment game better. And this little process, I'm going to have a next slide to talk about that a little bit more. It has its own criteria, which is important. In most of the academic research that I've seen, and you may find some examples that don't follow this, usually the test game is a game that it's finished. And the goal of the game, which is still valid and very useful, is to come up with proving some theories or come up with some design guidelines that's going to be useful for a game that's going to be built in future, but not necessary for that finished game anymore. Of course, our formative evaluation result going to inform some design guideline as well. So we are, as a user researcher in industry, we are not only focusing on improving one game, but we go to these conferences to share that knowledge that hopefully going to help with future games. Another scary slide, but this is the last one. Bill Fulton, I think, gave an awesome talk in GER Summit in 2012. And I used the basically seven criteria that he defined for applied user research. And that's, I used it a lot when I talk about methods, because they have to fit in these criteria if you want to do a applicable user research, or if you want to do a formative evaluation. And some of these are less important in academia. I feel that I may be okay to talk about this because I'm in a both side. So in industry, as Bill talked about them, you of course need to have representative users or build or platform and all those important stuff that you should watch his talk if you haven't seen that. You need to have accurate result. It has to be a specific. It has to fit in your time, the time that you have until the next build gonna be ready, usually a few days or a week. It has to fit in the cost that you have for the project. And as we heard earlier, being actionable and motivational are also very critical part of the process. In most of the academic work that I've seen, or even I created, I still have projects that they're been in development for 2 years, because there is no time pressure on that. You know, whenever it's done, it's okay. Cost effective, sometimes, but not always. Usually our work in academy are supported by government or other grants that, you know, they are more flexible with that, and so on, that I've listed here. So if I want to maybe suggest the framework to differentiate between the two type of the work, that's the one that I use a lot. So that's my last slide. Thanks so much for listening. It's been a pleasure talking to you guys, and I'm looking forward to your questions or chat in the coffee break or the social event tonight. I'm really, as you can probably tell, interested in the user research in academia and industry. I would love to have a discussion about that. Challenges in user research, especially with the new type of games that we are working on, it's cool. And as you probably know, I'm one of the co-editors of the GER book, so it's almost done, I promise. Should be out to the publisher before the new year. So. And thanks so much for the community to support that. Many of you here wrote a chapter for that book. You are awesome. And finally, as I said, the designer focus or developer focus version of this talk, I'm going to give it at MIX conference, the Montreal International Game Summit in November. So if you are in Canada or in Montreal, there is another version of this talk there. Thanks so much for listening. So yeah, I welcome any questions. Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
I just wanted to clarify your participant recruitment process. So you say you collect data from people to apply for this recruitment, and then you let the game developers choose the players?
Sorry?
You said, do you let the game developers then choose the players? Who is it that then sends out the invitations?
So, yeah, so basically there would be a discussion with them to define who's going to be the target audience for the test that we want to build. But the part, the filtering part and invitation part, that's the process that could save my time in order to make these things cheaper. So that's the part that they've been trained, and that's why training is an important aspect of that. So they've been trained and they've been provided with templates to follow when they want to contact and invite users. So yes, the developers would do that, but in a very carefully design process for not to biasing the result.
So you're relying on the developers to screen players who may actually have just filled out the form, maybe have lied or say they play certain games. So you're kind of putting ownership on the developers to choose the players. Like,
I mean, I think yes, and I think they should care about the result that they're getting. So that they're invested in the process as well. And yeah, it's all about adopting what we currently do and to see how it fits. So I'm not saying that might be the best way of doing it. That's what I currently do. There might be some issues that I don't know about, and I would like to hear about those as well.
Hi.
Hi.
My question is, you mentioned the tracking, live tracking data, and you use it in retrospection.
Yeah.
I wonder if there is a platform or a service that you would use for biometric live?
No, so that's...
And would you even do that?
So there are a few third-party platforms that we use. None of them would offer you what we want to do, so the live dashboard. And that's one of the benefits that I didn't maybe mention from this collaboration between industry and academic, because one of my master's students build that dashboard, so as part of his research project. So we have our own dashboard that we use for that, but it's been built by us. Yeah. Well, it wasn't too difficult, took a few months.
Okay, thank you.